If you stick your hand out of the window of a car that's moving fast enough, it will convince you that the fluid resistance is actually a real thing. In other words, the fluid, or air in this case, does impress a force on a body moving through it. So what really is happening here is that the moving body is exerting a force on the air to push it out of the way. And by Newton's third law, the air pushes back on the body with an equal and opposite force. And this force is opposite the direction of the body's velocity. So you see here, while the hand is moving in this direction relative to air, the force on it is in this direction. And in fact, recall a time when you actually did this, that is, stuck your hand out of the car window, and the faster you moved, the more resistance you felt. Also, you would have felt a smaller force when you tilted your hand, such that only the side of your hand cut through the air. Basically, you had decreased the area of your hand that faced the direction of motion. So you see, this force is quite different from the kinetic friction force between two surfaces in contact, which is independent of speed. So this force is called the drag force, usually represented with the letter D, and is given as D is equal to half C rho A V square, where rho is the density of the medium through which the object is moving, V is the velocity of the object, A is the cross-sectional area of the object moving through the medium, that is perpendicular to velocity V. So if an object is moving like this, then the area A to be considered is this only. And C here is a constant called the drag coefficient, measured experimentally and depends on the shape and size of the body and the properties of the fluid. So if you examine this formula, you can see that the drag force, or the force that slows down an object through a fluid, is directly proportional to the density of the medium, cross-sectional area of the body, and the square of the velocity. The more you have each of these quantities, more the drag force. So if you see a skier moving at a high velocity, you would see that they try to minimize the drag force to attain higher speed. Although as they attain higher speed, the drag force also increases because of their speed. But what they can control is their cross-sectional area that they try to minimize. So they kind of fold themselves in an egg-like shape to reduce the effective cross-sectional area. Now, recall that in our earlier lesson, we've always assumed air to have little effect on motion of a ball. But that is not correct. Air does have an effect. So let us go ahead and examine the motion of a ball as it falls from rest through air and how the drag force affects its motion. So to start with, we can say that since the velocity of the ball is pointing in the downward direction, the drag force is directed upwards. We can also say that since its velocity is increasing due to gravity, the drag force would also be increasing. So you see, this upward drag force is basically opposing the downward gravitational force on the body. And therefore, if we write Newton's second law of motion equation, F is equal to ma, what we get on the left hand side is D, or the drag force acting upwards, minus force of gravity acting downwards, and this should equal m into a. Now, since the velocity is increasing, the drag force is also progressively increasing. And after some time, when the ball reaches a certain velocity, this drag force becomes high enough and equals the force of gravity, or D equals fg. Which would therefore mean from this equation that ma equals zero, or acceleration becomes zero. And then the body's velocity does not increase anymore and it falls at a constant velocity called the terminal velocity, or vt. So with this understanding, it is easy to find an expression for terminal velocity. So in this equation, we will substitute for D as half C rho AV square and set this equation equal to zero. And what you get is VT is equal to root of 2FG upon C rho A. And you can substitute mg for fg over here to get this formula. So if you were to draw an acceleration graph for this ball that is experiencing a drag force, it would look something like this. Initially, when its velocity is zero, the acceleration would be g, but then as the velocity increases with time, drag force also increases, and since it is in the opposite direction, the net acceleration starts reducing and then approaches zero. And if there was no drag force, the graph would have looked like this. That is a straight line where the acceleration would have remained constant at g. Also, if you draw a velocity versus time graph for the same body, it would look something like this. Its velocity increases first, but then as the acceleration approaches zero, the velocity approaches a constant velocity or the terminal velocity. Again, if there was no drag force, the velocity would have just kept increasing because the acceleration due to gravity would have continued to act on the body, increasing its velocity. So I would suggest that you head over to this playlist that has a full set of lessons on friction and circular motion. And if you like this lesson, do leave a comment below. That'll be very helpful. And see you in the next lesson.